tuna, which is fished all along the place, can be processed here and exported to the European Union, with as a result that you attract factories for the canning of the tuna, and that you create jobs.
IPA gives Papua New Guinea and Fiji duty-free and quota-free access to the EU market in return for the gradual liberalisation of their markets over a 15-year period.
Those in favour, and that is adopted.
Se estima que la producción de atún se elevará finalmente a 400.000 toneladas al año, dirigidas al mercado europeo que consume actualmente un total de unas 710.000. El impacto será muy grave, ya que los precios del atún procedente de Papúa son un tercio más baratos que los europeos por los bajos salarios y los inexistentes estándares medioambientales.
Adopted the constitution, I made sure that we, government, did not declare the land as a state land. We allowed communities and we allowed the people to own the land. And if national government want development, we have to negotiate with the people. Yes, that's the biggest obstacle. And that's one oversight that we did.
Why are we giving the derogation to Papua New Guinea? I tell you why. It's because it's literally on the other side of the world.
You don't know now. Yeah. You don't know how we will going to stay here. How we are to live.
The place where we used to rely on to make gardens are now being occupied by RD and the proposed BMH. So we're going to do our gardening more better, so we are looking at other ways and means to survive.
What the hell is going on in Papua New Guinea today? What lies beyond the never-ending advocacy for GDP growth and numbers? Beyond the Western ideals that are shaping a landscape for the relentless pursuit of markets, economic growth and development? What happens when people are told to trade their foundations of life for a few cents paid work on cannery floors, to feed the world's biggest export markets?
There is suppression of the
and when, as a consequence, new laws get enacted and challenge the very core of one of the oldest culture? What happens when a government is caught up in the middle of a resource curse?
It's extraordinary that the rest of the world, or at least the rest of Western democratic world, is trying to restore to Indigenous people the rights to deal with their land. Whereas this government is managing to do what white colonial rule didn't do, which was strip the rights of the people, the Indigenous people, to protect their land. It's extraordinary.
Simba is me gone.
Just north of Australia lays the land of the unexpected, Papua New Guinea, a country largely ignored by Western media. The nation, which is home to nearly 7 million people, is one of the most resource-rich places on the planet. But this is also one of its biggest problems.
Trying to balance the resource curse in this country, because we have so much mineral wealth, and we have yet to actually get it around to the... We have so much corruption at the same time, so that mineral wealth has never seen its way back into the villages.
The top police chief estimates that half of the government's budget disappears into the pockets of corrupt bureaucrats and their private cronies.
There is corruption at different institutional level that is endemic, and it's a dynamic that is not easily, you know, nipped in the bud. I think it's a dynamic of a developing country like ours with huge gaps that just seems to cultivate that.
Papua New Guinea also carries the legacy of Bougainville. Perhaps you're thinking about this plant that gives a variety of impressive flowers. Or maybe this guy, Louis de Bougainville, the great 18th century French explorer who traveled the world and discovered the plant. Well, in Papua New Guinea, it means this. The longest armed conflict of the Pacific since World War II. At the roots of the conflict was this very big copper mine, controlled by the British-Australian mining giant, Rio Tinto.
Before reaching the final layers of overburden, they cleared 550 acres of jungle and sluiced away the unconsolidated volcanic rock and ash.
In the 1990s, this mine was a sparkle of a conflict which turned into bloodshed. As much as 10% of the island population may have been killed. The local people of Bougainville felt the environment was being destroyed with the release of dangerous chemicals directly into the rivers. They felt they were losing their land as large tracts of forest had to be cleared for the project. They felt the mining company, Rio Tinto, was not bringing much benefits to their lives. So, they revolted. A revolutionary army was born, the project shut down, and Rio Tinto kicked out of the country. The reason why we are telling you the story of Bougainville is because in Melanesia, you don't come in between people and their land. Back then, it was about copper and gold. Today, it is about tuna in Madang, the most peaceful town of the country. And once more, the promises of development carry the spectrum of a pending conflict. Desperate to get development for its people, the government is sending very strong messages to foreign investors.
I listen to you, you listen to me.
Yes.
I can't stop you. Police can't stop you. Government can't stop you. But the law, your right to freedom of speech, is presently suspended by the Supreme Court reference.
In May 2010, without any public consultation, the government went as far as changing its own environmental laws to be more business-friendly. It will soon follow a model found all over Southeast Asia of special economic zones, where multinationals can come in and set up their operations in a country, within a country, where government's control will be even more limited. The deal is crystal clear. An SEZ, or special economic zone, becomes appealing to foreign corporations by offering attractive regulations and taxes, so that a company can be deemed globally competitive on the world market. It's a system that helped the words made in China become famous. According to the World Bank, there is now more than 3,000 similar projects in 135 countries in the world. And today, the hero in this global competition is tuna. And PNG has a lot of tuna. So much that its waters became the largest provider of tuna cuts in the world, with more than 700,000 tons fished out last year. But this monopoly game does not really make Chris want to play that much.
Maybe sometime later you'll know that we have already gone into something like Bougainville.
Do you think violence would be the solution, the only solution?
Because I think using violence will be the solution because we have talked so many times and nothing has been done. We have talked to the government, we have talked to the politicians, but nothing has been done. Then that is why I think violence will only be the solution.
If we don't address that well, it is a potential time bomb. I fear that many of us in policy making aren't entirely sensitive to that. If we don't significantly address these issues, such as education, training, job creation, and also manage the influx of foreign employees, particularly the Asians, better, much better than we are, then it's likely to haunt us and blow up in our faces.
People here once were very independent, self-reliant, working in the gardens and catching fish for their source of food.
This man was talking about the impact that the first tuna cannery had on his village. Environmental degradation, the disappearance of fish, prostitution, miserable conditions at work, and a corrupt political environment. Enjoying special access duty and quota-free to the EU, the government wants to implement up to 10 more tuna canneries in Madang, right next to the existing Filipino operation. It would be the first special economic zone in the country, called the Pacific Marine Industrial Zone, or PMIZ. But for that man, this meant nothing less than the disappearance of his own people.
We, the resource owners, we will no longer have any things to earn our living. The number of fishing vessels will multiply, and we will not have any place to fish in. And this indirectly means that we will not have anything for us to survive. And it also means that we will be dying.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Madang.
Being immersed into sceneries like this, it doesn't take long before you feel pretty much in paradise. The beauty of the natural environment and the friendliness of the local people make you feel very privileged to be here. To understand anything about the tuna conflict, you first have to be aware of the way people live in PNG, especially the attachment they have to land. For these populations, fishing, hunting, and gardening have been the foundation of life for thousands of years.
Land is a very special thing to us Papua New Guineans. From a Melanesian perspective, land has always been providing for us. We have been here for 50,000 years. Our ancestors have been here for 50,000 years, and they have survived. The reason why we are still surviving today is because we still have our own land. Land is like money in Western societies. It is equivalent to money. Without land, basically, we don't have any life because we fish from the rivers, we drink from the rivers. People along the coast and on the islands, they live off the sea.
Those are floaters, the little place where we throw them down with the floater.
And people on the inland, and also the coastal people as well, and everyone basically lives from the land. They make gardens from the land.
Papua New Guinea is one of the most, you know, bio and culturally diverse places on Earth. You have about 800 different people, kinds of peoples, you know, we say that sort of a social cultural groups, 850 or so languages. And while they're related to each other, the idea of pluralism is very important here. Everybody's different for a reason.
80% or 85% of the people, they live on the land. They survive because they have gardens on the land. It's only 20% or 15% that are working in towns and cities.
In Australia, you have social security in terms of, you know, your payment. But that is, to Papua New Guineans, that is a social security. You're, even though you're in town, you don't have any food to eat. You still have your wontoks to give you the food.
So Papua New Guinea is a very special country where 97% of the land is still owned by the people, and that's customary land tenure.
The vast majority of people don't really live wholly on the cash economy, only in cities. So they live off of their land. And everyone here is a landowner. One of the great gifts that Australia ceded to Papua New Guinea when it left independence in 75 was the constitutional right to land. Customary land is very important, so that it's not possible to sell your tribal land to an outsider.
The problem now is that the government, the World Bank, and all other agencies, they are trying as much as possible to get land from the people, and we are trying as much as possible to try and educate our people to see the importance of their land so that they can stand strong and be able to resist the push that is coming in from our government and also from the outsiders as well.
Papua New Guinea is a latecomer in everything. We are the latecomers in terms of the Western system, globalization. And it's coming at a sudden rush, you know, rush water. If it rushes too big, that's it.
Glenn, what is the province? They come to hand with you. You here to go pass on, you know, you come up here.
Every time we discuss project plans, major developmental initiatives, the primary requisites are good governance machinery and strong, good, ethical, integrous leadership. From the highest level down to the most basic. Einstein also said, and I quote again, the significant problems we face cannot be solved at the same level of thinking we were at when we created it. That's why the challenge for change paradigm, change thinking.
This man, talking with great passion, is Arnold Amet. Before becoming Minister for Justice at the end of 2010, he was the governor of Madang.
We cannot hope to impose external models and structures to our Melanesian culture, people that are still living at that level, unless we've had decades of generational literacy and education that we can adapt to what is universal.
To give you an idea of the extent of change awaiting the Madang people, you don't need to look really far. The Chinese and Australian mining company is allowed to dump millions of tons of mining waste directly into Madang seas, where thousands of people fish every day. such a practice would probably be banned in China and Australia. But at a recent trial, where the validity of the environmental permit was challenged, the judge made an interesting decision. He found that despite probable catastrophic consequences for the environment, and despite the fact that this practice could be unconstitutional, it has to go ahead. Alternative methods of disposal would be too costly. The Chinese have already invested too much money, and halting the project would destroy foreign investors' confidence into the country. In other words, it is too late to complain. And with the PMIZ, things are also going quite wrong. For the very first time in its history, the International Finance Corporation has received an official complaint from indigenous people against the government. And guess who they are? The Madang people against their own PNG government. The International Finance Corporation, those guys who represent the private arm of the World Bank and who have been commissioned to write the legislation for the implementation of SEZs all around the country.
The Pacific Marine Industrial Zone is being developed as a special economic zone which will be enacted by Parliament. The legislation and policy framework is currently developed by the World Bank with the aim of creating an improved business regulatory environment, thus incorporating best practices of similar SEZs around the world for the zone and locators to be globally competitive.
Globally competitive. So with cheap clothes made in China or computer parts from India, we will get tuna made in PNG.
We're developing a whole town, a satellite town, 215 hectares. A whole new town. It's just going to have a total multiply effect in the range of industries that the shops that might set up to supermarkets and service stations. And it's just going to provide an enormous employment opportunity, I hope.
Fished out by nations such as China, Taiwan, or the Philippines, who get the fish and go process it back in their own countries. The PNG government only gets between 2 and 8% of the total value of the catch in licenses and access fees, which represent $50 million a year. It hopes to get more benefits by encouraging the delocalization of foreign canneries on SEZ land. This is one of the fastest success stories promoted by international institutions. A story of cities transformed into processing hubs. A story of people migrating in search of a better life. But foremost, a story of millions of landless peasants in Asia, Africa, Central and South America who have to make way for projects to go ahead. On the 19th of October 2011, 50 Madang families found themselves homeless after police and private security forces burned down their homes. For their loss, the families were allegedly given between $100 and $500. Why? Because they lived on state land. A state land not cleared for the PMIZ project, but a state land which remains for many a symbol of betrayal and a long road full of broken promises.
You can like mud and talk or ground by tomb back long if not resource so on. Then to make us in 6 months. Then to make us a man of the business of faith, and that long up long in here, no God. You mean a simple term, dictionary long street. You mean a man long class. Now you mean that all of it to write, and the resource long in here, human resource, whatsoever. So now you become long making sales and government is ours, you mean a right too.
To understand the conflict, we have to go back to the early days of the 20th century, when the German administration was then ruling over the province. They acquired land from local tribal groups with a pretty good deal. Hundreds of hectares of land against bush knives and a few trade goods. This piece of land was then given by the administration to the first German Catholic mission in the country, the Mission of the Holy Ghost, which is still represented today by the Eichschaffen Health Center and the St. Michael's School on the outskirts of Madang. During the 19th and 20th century, missionaries were sent to colonies to spread the divine word. Every Sunday represents a lasting colonial influence, where many people gather at the local parish to sing to the glory of the Lord.
Pockets of state land that were alienated by the German and the British and then Australian administrations of necessity to start colonial and administrative centers. All of our towns are based on the state land principle, but everything else is owned by local customary landowners. And that's what's kept Papua New Guinea wealthy. If you alienate all of the land, then you have basically a peasant economy whereby people have to work as landless peasants on other people's land in order to live in a horticultural society, which they live in as it is. So that's allowed people to live on the land, to live outside the cash economy, or only loosely based on this cash economy.
On the Rempi land, the Catholic mission developed plantations. While living, the surrounding villages used parts of it for necessary subsistence agriculture. The church would return the land when the mission would not be able to care for it anymore. But tensions between local people and the mission grew in the 1950s. The church tried to register as much as 4,000 hectares from the Rempi land, and the result was a series of court cases that lasted more than 20 years. In one of them, a local man explained that his ancestors had been cut short, as they did not speak Tok Pidgin, the language used for trade back then, and now one of the official languages. After all, the deal would have been made using sign language. In the end, the court ruled in favor of the Catholic mission, who later sold the land in 1991 to the provincial government. The local people expected the land to be returned to them, but instead, and without their knowledge, more than 800 hectares were sold to RD Tuna, the Filipino company who established its first cannery. It is on this very land that the Pacific Marine Industrial Zone is currently being built.
The land, unfortunately, over the decades had been expropriated.
You will make it all able to come back?
Yes!
You will make it all able to come back?
Yes!
That's the colonial history of that part of our country, and I think part of our going forward is to see how this land is then developed economically, either in partnership with the people.
You better make it more about natural resources, and you'll come back.
Yes!
Or by government and other developers to see these other developmental opportunities benefiting our people. So that's really just part of our history.
This man, standing next to a government representative, is Willie Basin. He has been leading numerous protests against the PMRZ. Having previously worked with the RD Tuna Company, he is now trying to educate people about the sorts of consequences that such projects have on local life.
The whole portion of the land across, right here across to Maiwara Bay and all the way to Vidar. They put it on auction sales, professional auction sales, and they came up with bidding, and RD won. RD was a successful bidder at the time. And so as traditional landlords, we haven't have our consent about that land and that transaction also. So taking our land away would be a disaster, because it's the start of where the poverty would be. Because we would be hungry at that time. Because we got land, we are not hungry. We have coconut to eat, we have banana trees, we have pawpaw trees, we got everything. So when land is taken away, we're going to be poor. That's our belief here also, cultural belief.
You're putting an enormous strain on the landowners themselves. They are living in their own little settlements and overpopulated. They themselves can't even move out onto their own land. And now they can't grow. The real true Madang people are not able to grow as they should be. That's the problem with state land. It's actually repeated all over in towns all over the country. But it means that they have nowhere to go.
You find it in the most disempowered people in the country, people that are in project areas. When I say project areas, I mean areas where large-scale operations are taking place, fishing operations, mining operations, logging operations, that kind of development. And those are the most disempowered people in the country.
In Madang, some of the most disempowered people can also be found on Seg Island. They belong to what the government labeled impact area communities. For generations, the more than 1,000 people that have inhabited this island have lived off the sea by trading fish at markets. They also used to harvest the mainland, right where the PMIZ is now being built.
Customers from the town come to the beach down there to the Alexafel, uh-huh. And they buy it, and then we come back.
On Seg Island, we met with Leo Ackfield, a fisherman who welcomed us into his tribe. He was willing to share the story of his people since our day, the first Filipino-owned tuna cannery arrived in 1997.
That's the island before. I mean all same. That's the island and come a paradise. Let me come up Narapala Kainorgata. Na time mi pula sabe or mam la place mi pula seksim kanu. Na time mi pula sego outside. Mi pula sego long way. Mi pula stop arat sa long. Aus pula mi pula long. Na ambis ta sa putim angga I gona long rip. Na mi pula slekim sa rop go outside. And mi pula seksim or peace. Ba mi pula mas sinkim long nus pula kanu long upside. I go long upside. Mi pula come back morning or mama be go long market. All be sal in peace. Na desela stop long mi pula blong before desela money mi pula say kisim. And mi winning blong now mi pula work one time RD. Na aw amas blong mi pula on man long place. And mi nice, na mi nice all get there.
Company no come yet, and mi plus stop riches. Mi plan been short long plus something no long life from mi plan. Everything is mi plan na patok. Mi piso kai kai want him something. We got land long plan him something grow something else to eat. We don't find hard. Na peace mi plan na sa find him peace no. Mi plan survive long peace. O say mi no place long mi plan not like o say mi plan live long era blam plan. O say mi plan float or foreigners. Kind of say mipla live now.
Mipla isi long painim kai kai na baim school fee blog pikini olga ta planti pikini sa kolo school. Na now na igo em no gat. Sa tamol company kami sa tol bagrabi solwara blog mipla.
One kind of pikini blog me now. I'm stop from beyond was kalabos. Long sat no pista so long adi. Na I'm stop long bite catch. All walk long kissim, all walk long crabs, all put him all long sail. Bite him all, swear him all. People walk long, hard long finding money, long gone, and belly more come out.
We don't want them to stay too, and we don't want this marine park to want them. We don't want.
I know that now by Yumi best up or something, but government may become on him long Yumi. Me toki mi no kirap nang display island on nogat. No company sim giron and mi play in nogat mo display now. Now mi play pull go long island, long mainland, mi play walk so this island to and company kisim. And mi walk long Giaman. Giaman promise mi play nothing long all kind something become up long place. That's all still this one something and mi no come up.
I don't worry about us, but we are thinking of these kids. How will they survive later on?
I appeal to all the youths around the world to say no to the PMI jet. If they say no, that will save us. And I'm appealing from my heart to them to say no to PMI jet.
We also had the privilege to be invited to a special landowner meeting organized by a local politician, James Sungai.
What are the Adi doing here? What are the government doing here? And then Marine Park is coming down PM jet. That's a funny idea. No development and more to come.
Let us plan life. Blow slow on the ground. Blow you sick. Arab. You know, blow Guarbato. You know, blow Matran. You know, blow Panifon. Arab. Hey, blow sick. All seven of me want to Caspar. Me blow Marito, you blow. Me blow a diner, you blow. Time you blow cooperate and pass.
Because people in PNG are so spread out into different clans, culture, and traditions, it is very difficult for them to reach a consensus and speak with a common voice. Coming from this perspective, men and women like Boyne Kaspar, an activist from a local NGO, are literally trying to teach people that their cause is not a lost one.
You are not a fool. You should start realizing things. The company has been fooling you so long. And are you going to sit and wait and feel the pain and suffer? Are you animals? If you're not animals, then start thinking. Ika, two big project inside long country, na especially lo miple inside the province, and two big project putting good yao. One, CMCC Chinese Material Construction Company, where like si cobalt na nickel and tap long, yandra na or China like si migo. One, two, Pacific Marine Industrial Zone lo ya. All project lo government. Okay, mipla ya long kananam. Niblon Papua Crown lo kana nam niblon indai solwara e manin na to place blue blan solwara e manin tru na stap na all Papua Crown lo pasamuk all tok nokat all tok nokat na all fight ya okay all fight tambu blue mi putin gutya lo displa all fight ya all tok nokat company juni na blue puti pipia konsolong solwara blue mi bla mi bla no like him. All kisim company want them, government go to court.
Here is Stephanie Twyvey, the woman who had tried to prevent the dumping of millions of tons of mining waste directly into the sea. It was the first chapter into what the media labeled the David versus Goliath case. She has been battling for the last decade to defend indigenous people's rights and is now starting a new fight with the PMIZ.
Papua New Guinea is, without doubt, one of the richest nations in the South Pacific. We have massive oil, gas resources, gold resources, and amazing fish resources. But still, at the moment, we are in the top 10 of infant mortality in the world. How can this be? And one has to say it's about the planning. It's about planning the use of resources. Papua New Guinea survives a great deal on the income from its natural resources, but the planning of the utilisation of the resources just isn't there. And that is definitely the case for this Pacific Marine Industrial Zone. There's no tuna fishery management plan to figure out how this, the tuna resource is going to cope with 10 new canneries, particularly from the Asian region. There's no planning about where the 20,000 sweatshop workers will live, where their kids will go to school, what hospitals they'll use. The planning is completely woeful, to the extent that the whole project is illegal because there's no legislation which allows an economic zone to be set up in Madang.
I think there's no ulterior motive. I think the government wanted this. Our institutional capacity is really the drawback in making sure that these structures and the frameworks are in place. That's really our experience in many of these developments. Because of the gaps, we are trying to keep pace with the investor confidence. and the industry is coming. If that confidence wasn't there and we had to work with the few, then we might manage that better. But there's just such an influx.
This block project that you play thing also named by staff or set us on loyal, that you by benefit nobody by looking money. No way. Tomorrow this block resource and finish. Hardly pick up and go. Now hardly and pick up now go. Now over to this block back up, this block pick back hardly walking Gurania. You by stop, you by get this level by you start.
No,
look at by you go to the Philippines. You know not go to the Philippines, you're ground blue, you're by stop, you stop talking about your land. And it's serious.
So what happened to the fish? We went looking for it with other fishermen in Segaba. Jordanum is a local fisherman from the mainland who has been fishing here for the past 28 years. He tells a very similar story to what we heard on Segaland. Catching fish in the harbor is now increasingly difficult as he has to travel further and further away to catch the same amount of fish needed to feed his family.
Hardy tuna came in and that's the first one that makes everything go corrupt. It's hard to live because it'll destroy everything. Our reef, our fishing ground. Years ago, we usually catch fish around this area. We catch more fish, but now we don't. Because too much noise, too much pollution, that's why we don't catch a lot of fish. So we don't know how we're gonna live again. Because we coastal area, we have no land, no big land. Because up at the mountain, there's people there.
The Madang Lagoon, where Segaba is located, is one of the most biodiverse places in the world. Here, there are more than 700 types of corals and more than 1,000 different species of reef fish, which pushed the government in partnership with NGOs to establish 4 wildlife marine areas. Yet Hardy Tuna and the PMIZ are right in the middle of the lagoon. The environmental impact statement of the PMIZ goes well beyond the observations of Jordanum. The loss of traditional fishing grounds, food security problems, the destruction of reef ecosystems with potential legal implications of a project established next to marine areas. The erosion of shorelines may result in the displacement of local villages, and people might die from the consumption of contaminated water. And among the potential causes for the loss of fishing grounds for the Seg people, oil spills. And here they are. This very distinct waistline could be followed for hundreds of meters, going back all the way to the harbor. Here is an anonymous source close to the company's operations who wants to share a little more.
I can confirm it. It's every day there is oil spill there. And we usually apply oil detergent to the oil spill to separate oil spill with the water. There is always a waste oil and then plenty of diesel and fuel, petrol, and then marine paints. They usually paint at the wharf and then a whistle. Sometimes the chemical dissolve the oil, but it cannot dissolve every oil.
But the oil stays in the environment. It is still, even if it's not visible, it still remains in the sea.
Yeah, it still remains in the sea. Hardy vessels are not seaworthy because there is plenty of rust there. It's not, the vessel is not fit enough to fish. That's why there's always leakage from the bottom of the vessel. That's why there is always an oil spill there. There is no any controls there. There is no anybody who is responsible for the oil spill to come and see.
European Union has donated a lot of money through that project. So European countries also have the major buyers from the Tardy products.
So they come here for inspection at times. You know, when they come for inspections, all 1 week, we usually do cleaning up and all those no good work. We don't work there. No fish handling, unloading whatsoever, because conditions of the workmen, of the workers there, also not good. So they don't allow workers to work while inspection is going on. And also those fishing fleets, most of them are old ones. They just modified with paint and all those. So those buggered ones, when they had the date for that inspection, they usually go out. So when the inspection finished, they come back.
But while the population blames the company for the shortage of fish, environmental groups such as WWF say it is impossible to link the water degradation to Hardy tuna because no scientific water quality assessments were conducted before its arrival.
We can see some general trend of decline in water quality. Hardy tuna is probably what people see, but it's also because of the settlements, the villages that are located along the lagoon, as well as the township of Madang. Without proper sewage system, I think human waste is also a big contributor.
Hardy tuna boats operating in PNG have mostly been built more than 25 years ago, and it is the responsibility of the Department of Environment and Conservation to monitor the adverse impacts that industrial development brings to the country.
I have to acknowledge that that is very poorly managed. I think industry recognizes that in many of the major extractive industry developments that are capacity to monitor the environmental impact, such as that depositing of waste in the riverine, in the sea. It'll take some years to really bring that capacity to address that. In the meantime, there'll be spillage. I think the political drive is such that we'll live with that spillage.
We have at pretty much the worst mining-related disaster in the world, with the Octeti mine destroying the Fly River. There was meant to be a tailings dam. It failed. It wasn't fixed quickly, and the tailings went into the river, and the government just gave up pretty much and has allowed that to continue. Now we have 800 kilometres of destroyed river. Now, when you have rivers, people relying upon that river for their every sustenance, it's devastating, and it will be ruined for hundreds of years. We also have the Bougainville copper mine. That was abandoned during due to a civil war. However, that war's been over for some time, and there's still minerals, dangerous metals, leaching out into rivers and into the environment. What's the Department of Environment and Conservation doing about that? Absolutely nothing.
Y a fin de dar entrada a los inversores asiáticos, Papúa ha enmendado su legislación para que no sea posible presentar denuncias por daños medioambientales y ha puesto en marcha una normativa de inversiones que permite contratar a trabajadores tanto locales como mano de obra barata procedente de Asia con las peores garantías laborales que quepa imaginar.
The concerns with capacity to monitor, address these issues become secondary to let's get the development, let's balance it the best way we might be able to going forward. And if that happens to fall by the wayside, then, you know, the balance is a bit like that rather than up here.
Right, the balance. In a place where preserving the balance between people and their environment is essential to guarantee the self-reliance of the population, you would think that governments would make decisions to protect their own people. In May 2010, the then Somari government took a rather drastic decision. They amended their own environmental laws and gave brand new superpowers to the DEC, the Department of Environment and Conservation.
It's absurd. It will affect PMIZ, it will affect Rama Nickel, every project. If a mining company was dumping into a river pursuant to its permit, dumping mine tailings, and then for whatever reason decided to dump into river number two, but that wasn't included in its permit, and say 3 years down the track, the landowners further down the river discovered that there were no fish left and vegetation was dying along the sides of the river. If they started agitating, the mining company could simply write
to the Director of the Environment and ask for a retrospective authorisation of that behaviour, and that also for a certificate of necessary consequence, that the environmental harm was a necessary consequence of that dumping. Now, the Director of the Environment now has the power to just write a letter back and authorise it retrospectively and grant that certificate. That process is completely unsupervised. There's no checks and balances. That decision is unreviewable, unchallengeable. The landowners couldn't sue for compensation. Plus, they couldn't sue for an injunction to stop it. Particularly, and why that would be important, is that that dumping process wouldn't have gone...
Retrospective powers? In the hands of one man? Unreviewable? Unchallengeable? Denying the rights to sue? The rights for compensation? This is big. Can someone help us?
No, I'm not aware that that's the case. I must confess I haven't immediately studied the legislation. But our discussions in government is that that's not intended to deny the fundamental constitutional rights of our people to take concerns like environmental damage to the environment to court for compensation and so on.
If the man who has been Chief Justice of the country for 10 years, Governor of Madang, and who, as we interviewed him, was about to become the Minister for Justice, hasn't read the laws, then who has in Papua New Guinea?
One body, love, love, Michael Samare.
We'll also face the dilemma of having development at any cost. At any cost. Any cost to the environment, any cost to the social impact that it'll have within the population that those developments will be placed into. And then within that, just the issues around the governance in delivering these developments as well.
And then we have to look at who the person is. It's the Director of the Environment, Dr. Wari Iyamo. In an Ombudsman Commission investigation that went over 2 years into the grant of a large forest area, Kumula Doso, to a Malaysian logging company, the Ombudsman Commission recommended that Dr. Wari Iyamo, who was on the Forest Board at the time, be terminated for negligence. Well, the report was given to the Prime Minister in 2002, and not only is Dr. Wari Iyamo the Director of the Environment, he's still on the National Forest Board. It's dangerous to give anyone that power, but certainly someone who has been found lacking in the past.
That's all about democracy. We're talking about democracy. And we're not talking about kleptocrats, authoritarian, or dictatorship. No. The me because in the 2012 national election, me by me put the gun in charge of car, me by me car campaign.
Media from ground Papua New Guinea come, the whole thing look him, now me ask him, Mokata Papua New Guinea, lot of work, he can cry by me, now lot of work, they come and rule in parliament, now stop him as the government. Stop him as the government, the world becomes a stop him. Now the law is a law. All from world for the come, the citizen, the right, the best right for me.
Yes!
How can such a thing happen? Basically, in a fight to prevent the dumping of mining waste into the sea, Tiffany challenged an environmental permit and obtained an injunction that temporarily halted an Australian and Chinese mine. But the prospect of seeing a $1.6 billion nickel and cobalt mine endangered did not go down well with the government. So they justified themselves. A matter of utmost national significance. The risk that environmental permits may not be valid and enforceable for all major mining and development projects? Past, present and future?
Sometimes laws do get through. I mean, in all jurisdictions, in all legislatures, laws sometimes get passed through without the detail, the study of them. And we've had laws, once they're fully understood, being then advised and challenged in court and struck down as being unconstitutional. If advice is given earlier in the piece and we recognise that, the government will withdraw it and correct it. So the government is yet to fully study this particular series of amendments that has been complained of.
Your right to freedom of speech is presently suspended by the Supreme Court reference. So why? Because the court is going to interpret whether it's constitutional or not, you might not be right. So,
You might wonder if we are the only ones to ask questions. Well, not really. The United Nations do too. And they ask a lot more than we do about the amendments, but also a series of other laws whose constitutionality should have been reviewed by the Supreme Court years ago, such as the Prohibition of Foreign Legal Proceedings Act 1996, which prevents landowners to sue multinationals outside of Papua New Guinea for compensation.
What are they protesting over?
The environment.
The environment? They're protesting over the environment?
Environment, yeah. That party, no God. Government, company. That party, no. Papa Grand, no God. So Papa Grand protest.
Back on the road, we continued exploring the local villages surrounding the PMIZ. We headed towards Kananam, a place known to have some of the most vocal opposition against the project. We finally met with the family of Francis Gem, remember, the YouTube guy that got us here in the first place. Since he did the YouTube video, the government has tried to change Francis' views by flying him over to General Santos on a trip to the tuna capital of the Philippines. He was shown other canneries operated by the RD Corporation, but again fell short of being fully convinced.
Recently, last year, I went to the Philippines in a place where they called Subic, where there are some local people there called the Aitas. These local people, the Subic Bay was their traditional land. But now, because the government has taken over all that pieces of of land, the local hiatus are now kept in the zoo with the animals. Now, this is exactly what will happen to our people if the government don't listen to us. The concept is an Asian concept, a Filipino concept. So exactly what is happening there at Subic Bay will be happening here.
I think it's based on the Melanesian concept of social reciprocity concept. Okay, me give you a boy, you get that boy and chew it, and we are friends. But if I give you a boy and you don't chew and not give it back to me, you regard it as an enemy now. You'll be chased out. And that's what happened in Bougainville. We offered the boy chewing to BCL. Okay, BCL chewed, but he didn't give back to us. So we said, this is according to our custom, that's not good.
They cleared 550 acres of jungle.
And that lesson should be also learned with regard to this project.
Give him all crowd with step by first person, give now by fight.
Yes.
Just talk him all go, kiss him all come now by the present, give now by talk to all living all mangy for plus all by go back. All the time. So you think him? Go now, talk him all, kiss him all this little leader come, talk him all boom, go now.
Me talk him, I'm talking to yourself. Suppose all leader man through, all must come challenge me inside lawyer. This is where the all plenty all leader all stop inside. M talk myself. But suppose if like disagree law leader, I must play this all leader. Sir, all can go inside now. Go challenge me inside.
Our youngsters are now thinking of taking up arms to fight against the government and any developer that comes into our land because nobody is trying to listen to us now or our issues and concerns.
Do you think there could be a new Bougainville?
There will be a new Bougainville crisis here. We have already mentioned it to the government in one of the meetings that we held with the government. We also told them that there will be a Bougainville crisis if you don't listen to us.
There's some lady prostituting with RD boats. They exchange sex for fish. But plenty of ladies here are doing this. I cannot say one or two. It's plenty. Those kind of activities were never existed in Canada. It's only when RD came in, we started to have that kind of problems. Firstly, they when RD came in, they were using, they do trading, exchange trade, like Our women bring vegetables, they bring fruits to the boat, and the people on the boat give them fish. That's sort of, they exchange the trade. But it went to an extent where it changed.
There's now a very common, you know, phrase. It's like one fuck, one fish. Pardon my language, but it's one quap, one fish for the sailors out there. And it's not necessarily these sailors. It's the sailors, the culture of sailors in general. We have been accused of being anti-Filipino and being anti, you know, fishing, you know, the fishing industry itself around the South Pacific is notorious for creating prostitution.
I see that the people in this community are not prepared at this time. I also see that there's no government workers coming in to create awareness to the people what is going to happen. It's not like in the past years when I know that when development is coming, there's a lot of government workers coming in, telling the people what's going to happen. They should start preparing themselves for the development. For this PMIZ that is coming up, I haven't seen anybody coming in to tell the people what is going to happen, what the government is going to do for them. There's nothing.
Catch one.
The situation at the present time is Chinese boats, Thai boats, boats of other Asian nationalities fish in Papua New Guinean waters, and they land their fish back in their own country, giving no opportunity for development in Papua New Guinea. We often complain in our development policy that we do not do enough to encourage downstream activity. Here we're actually doing something positive for downstream activity.
We've been told time and time again that what people in the Western and Central Pacific region need to do is take control of the resource. By allowing foreigners to come and invest here and have easy access to the resource, we're giving the fish away.
I think we can learn from across Asia, in particular, some of the key concerns: low wages, lack of safety for workers, flight of foreign investment, so your profits get repatriated quite quickly, and governments have no control.
What makes that even worse is that the new regulations by the European Union, which were put in place to encourage investment by Indigenous people in the tuna fishing industry, are being completely used by RD Tuna and other foreign investors for their own financial benefit.
This is almost like an area where governments have no control over profits, over workers' conditions, and so you're creating enclaves within a sovereign state where companies can do whatever they feel like in the name of getting foreign investment into your country.
So the people behind this Pacific Marine Industrial Zone aren't Papua New Guineans trying to have equity in the resource, but Filipinos, Chinese, Thai people that are taking advantage of the European Union rules of origin and also the laws in Papua New Guinea, which allow 100% foreign-owned entity to just become a Papua New Guinean company.
What are the effects on the global fish stocks, on illegal fisheries, on employment and environment in PNG, and what are the social conditions for the workers?
The deprival of the people's land for gardening that had been taken place many, many years ago might now be compensated by cash economy. And that's the balance, and some of the prices of the kind of economic development that we are trying to bring to our people.
With the PMIZ, one of the arguments which comes back the most in order to support the project is the creation of opportunities for local people to create their own businesses, which will serve the major project. The government is financing the building of the infrastructure of the marine zone through a $72 million loan coming from the Exim Bank of China. This agreement guarantees that 70% of the infrastructure will be built by Chinese companies and labor, leaving 30% to local people at this stage of the project. Yet these opportunities for spin-off businesses have largely failed for more than 10 years with RD Tuna.
Like all developers, RD was promised that they would have spin-off benefits to the community. Not only would they hire local people, but then that the service industries surrounding it, like grass cutting, security, transportation for the workers, catering, food, would all go to local businesses. And that's kind of, that's the perk that the government always picks up and sells a new project by. Oh, spin-off benefits will benefit all of us. But those spin-off benefits were piece by piece by piece returned to RD Tuna. The transport has remained primarily Papua New Guinea, and the rest of the services have been abandoned, like the catering went to Filipinos eventually, and all these other things sort of lapsed.
If anything, the compensation for the loss of fish and land should come from inside the companies working on processing lines and cannery floors. RD Tuna in PNG now employs more than 3,500 workers coming from all around the province. It was the first major industrial development for people in the area. Wages at RD started at 70 toya an hour, the equivalent of 25 cents in US dollars. After many years of complaints, the company eventually raised the salaries over 35 cents, which made a normal employee go home after a standard week of work with a little bit more than 15 US dollars.
With an ordinary pay packet in an environment like ours, goods from the shelves of shops are very expensive these days, and you know, you cannot live on that type of money.
This is Joe Harre. He used to be one of the only Papua New Guineans to ever hold a managerial position at RD Tuna.
Being in charge of the workforce, I had to make sure that the workers looked after properly according to the laws of our country. So when I saw that the conditions were not being fulfilled, or what the requirements that I was expecting the company to do was not being fulfilled, so I had to just put in my resignation and leave the company.
I think what you do subject your people to is this underpaid, low-skilled work. And when you take them from where they have security in terms of their land and access to land and food production to put it into low-skilled jobs, then you have a situation that you don't want, where you see an increase in poverty.
When you have the people on the factory floor, they are the people who stand there all night and all day, and they work their guts out. You can have the best machines, you can have the best boats, ships, anything at all that's mechanical, you can have it. But without the human being, that particular piece of equipment is useless. It cannot operate itself. So therefore, I consider the people as very important. We have to pay them, we have to compensate them in order to make them happy. And when we make a person happy, you can expect the best out of them.
40% of people in Papua New Guinea live under a dollar a day. But trading the security of working on the land for cash jobs is not as beneficial as it might seem. The government imposed in 2008 on companies like RD Tuna a new minimum wage for non-agricultural jobs. In local currency, an average worker who provides for his partner and three school-aged children, would spend 84 kina a fortnight for a 1 kilo bag of rice. He would also spend 17 kina of basic tin fish. Finally, he would need 38 kina for a 10 kilo bag of flour, needing in total 192 kina a fortnight in order to survive. These calculations do not include basic needs such as soap, water, school fees, and potential medical costs. With the new minimum wage, a worker would take home 201 kina a fortnight. Yet in August 2010, 7 months after the new law, RD Tuna was still not paying any of its employees the new legal minimum wage.
Last time happened, me as a lead person, I told all my workers, we will go on strike because we are being paid under unskilled rate. It's 1 kina 72. And I went there and talked to one of the management there. And he told me, if you want to talk about rate, I will send all of you off. And I will pay, bring all the Asians here and work. They will replace you and work here in the net department. Then I feel like I cannot speak anymore because he told me, if you don't want to this rate, you just go home. Then what will I say? I have nothing else to say. So I have to tell all my workmen, we just cope up with the rain. If you don't want, we'll all go home. And that is why we are still working now with this rain.
I think it's the company's got very good motives. Because I know the management of the company, especially the owners of the company, they are genuine in what they want to do here in Papua New Guinea. But I think the blame should solely lay on the middle management, the people who are actually based here, who are actually running the company on behalf of the owners. They are the people who are not actually following the expectations of the owners of the company.
Kapan ito? 229. Kapan ini luksa belum mi plus. Mula pilih pen bet lago for to beginning plan January. January kam kakan na mi plus plan number 7 moon. Ro disla mi plan lokim kai kai blom so disla la. Ha tok mi plan making so so strike am 2 plus 2 ante mi plan making.
Mi plan hatok na tena mo karim big plan mane go beglo. Ground blom hol na mi plan wasting money wasting time blom mi plan lo. Disla kampane so now mi plan lagi mo so disla. Samdi mi plan tok tok hol mas mege sapo soli no making.
In Madang, we tried to meet with the managing director of RD Tuna, Pete Selso, but he refused to go on the record, stating that he was allergic to cameras. So in order to get a corporate perspective into the problem, we turned to Stodik Gamia, the president of Madang Chamber of Commerce, who also worked as a community relations officer with the company. He stated the reasons why the company was trying to obtain an exemption of the new legal minimum wage.
You have 3,500 workers. Now, no investor would be in his, you know, right kind of mind to have that and pay people 229, and the business will just close down and go home. So they want. Whether to scale down the manpower, there would be another strategy that they might look at, or maybe look at, you know, can't afford to pay everybody. So the exemption was really done as part of, you know, the submission to the government to really let the government know that, look, Adi is also paying this meal allowance, also paying the transport allowance, and do we have to exempt it from certain portion of that? So that's the application by Adi, like any other industries that they've applied. But up till now, the national authorities haven't come back to Adi yet, but obviously Adi will still pay this 229 anyway.
It wasn't the first time that the company faced labor unrest. Back in 2004, more than 200 Filipino fishermen seized a dozen of vessels from a fleet that belonged to RD Corporation. They protested against their conditions of work and wages. At the time, local media reported that the company was facing a risk of losses of up to $200,000 a day due to the strike. Very little is known about what happens on board fishing vessels in the world. If Greenpeace estimates that 40% of the world fish catches are currently unreported and illegally transshipped, which could lead to fishless oceans by 2050, little consideration has been given to people like Alfred Yempe, who joined RD Tuna to work as a deckhand for more than 10 years.
I've been working with RD Fishing for almost 10 years. I do quite a lot of job on board. The weather is always bad, but we have to work night and day for almost 16 hours a day.
Alfred has been doing one of the most dangerous professions in the world, on board vessels that can sometimes go for months at sea without hitting shore.
We wake up around 3 o'clock in the morning. We had our tea, get ready and prepare for the job. We started working when the net goes down. We haul the net. During hauling, it takes about 2.5 hours hauling. Hauling, it takes a lot of job. We haul our floaters, cables, rope for almost 3 hours. And then we bring in the fish. It's about 9 to 10 o'clock. We load the fish, it's from 10 to 11. If the catch is small, then we load the fish till 12 o'clock. 12 o'clock, we finish hauling, we have to clean up the deck, wash the deck, get the deck tidy up. Then we had our lunch. 1 o'clock, we start work again. We do repair. We go out searching for another catch. Even during those times, we do transshipment. If there is a plenty fish, we transfer it to the catcher boat. Sometimes we finish around 10 p.m. Then we go to sleep until 2 in the morning. Then 3 o'clock, we got started again.
Up until 2008, RD Tuna employed 57 local workers, all professional seafarers, who worked alongside a majority of Filipino fishermen on board RD vessels.
10 years ago, the company, before we joined the company, they told us so many interesting things that could benefit us. We'll be paid overtimes, we'll be given vacation leave entitlements, we'll be given sick leave entitlements, we'll be given media allowances, even public holidays will be paid. But all these things never happen. After we signed up, all these promises are just empty promises. None of these things will be paid to us by the company. It was only a dream.
Since 2003, you have never been paid any overtime whatsoever?
Actually. Even those ones that they started before me, the condition is the same till today.
For 16 hours, we were just being paid 8 hours a day. No overtimes, no Sunday, no any other income.
For more than 10 years, Alfred and his compatriots have been writing to the local labor office and the company management to denounce what they consider to be an unfair treatment, but they never got any positive replies. So at the end of 2008, they took a strong decision. They tried to join a union independent from the company.
They forced us that if we join the Maritime Workers Union, then we'll be terminated or we'll be fired from our jobs.
On the 27th of January 2009, 29 PNG seafarers, who were then waiting on shore for their next assignment, were summoned to a special meeting at the company's headquarters.
They said they will reimburse our affiliation fee. The affiliation fee was 7 kina per member. But during the time they brought us into the room, they gave us 100 kina each, so which is this. Actually, it's sort of a bribery.
Each seafarer took the bribe, but the next day complained to the PNG Maritime and Transport Workers Union. In Port Moresby, we met with his secretary, Donas Malaway. He said despite years of complaints to both management and labor officers, the company has been refusing to deduct a union membership, which means that they still cannot be covered.
I read it in a case in Madang was reported to the labor officer in Madang. The labor officer was calling, talking to us, and was talking to the employees who were prepared to join our union. At the same time, he was advising this Aradi Tuna company to avoid all this. He was supposed to be an independent fellow advising both parties on the situation. He assisted the Aradi Tuna to set up their own union.
Local media did pick up on the story at the time, but the responses from the company management were then even more surprising. Even though PNG Constitution guarantees freedom of association for its citizens, they claimed that there was an existing agreement between Aradi Fishing and their own internally run union, which called for the resignation of any employee willing to join an outside union. The management also explained that the difference in treatment between Filipinos and Papua New Guineans was because Alfred and his friends were contracted as Aradi Tuna employees, while the other fishermen are employed by other chartering companies, which, by the way, also belong to Aradi Corporation.
I feel the company is cheating and it's stealing from us. They get most of our resources. They talk us lie. But what they did, they treat us like animals. From our sweat, we did a lot. But in return, we were being underpaid.
There is a poverty in the world. We need to deal with this. One part is this transfer of financial sources, money, but it's much better really to give the people opportunities for the work where they can make a decent living from the work they do.
It's extraordinary. What would need to happen in the future is either the Papua New Guinea government control registration of foreign companies, or the European Union will need to change its EPA again when it says a PNG-owned or PNG company or a company that's in one of those countries. It needs to be over 50% citizen-owned or 100% citizen, indigenous citizen-owned. The whole idea is to encourage the indigenous people to develop industries, and they don't have to be huge industrial strength fishing. It can be artisanal fishing, pole and line fishing, catching fish, selling to freezers that can export tuna loins, frozen tuna loins, to Europe.
Trade is far from simple, say. But as I told, the only way really to eradicate poverty, it allows the growth in the developing world.
30 years ago, at the time of independence, there was an enormous wave of decentralized development theory. And it is generally in the world moved back to that. Everyone would tell you about Africa and South America, get people out of the cities and have them working businesses on their land. That idea, in general, has yet to kind of hit full force in Papua New Guinea. So we're still working on old models whereby if you have an industrial base, therefore we would, you know, it would balance our export-import, you know, debt.
I think in the Pacific we're quite unique. I think we're unique in the sense that, unlike other places in the world, our people still have access to land. And I think if you look right across the Pacific, the majority of our people, between 40 to 80, even close to 90% of our people, still live in that traditional sector, if you like.
You really have to get more smallhold agriculture things happening, because people want to go back to their village. They want to sit on their land. They want to, you know, exploit their land and live happily and raise children in peaceable communities.
There's research being done to demonstrate that our traditional economies do contribute to formal economies. And I think governments have got to reorient themselves into valuing this traditional sector. It's a source of stability. When you look at conflicts, it's our source of stability. It's certainly the thing that keeps us above poverty.
In a sense, there's the reaction, the conflict that's going on in us between some of our accepting and understanding of that reality and dynamics that's taking place in the developed world. With our own peculiar developmental dynamics we're trying to manage.
The resilience of our people, the Papua New Guinean people, is, I think, the foundation of where our hope lies. I mean, it is within their resilience that we will be able to overcome some of the challenges that we're facing now.
All the institutions have been stressed to the limit, and the pace of development has exceeded our capacity. So the addressing of the needs will take some time. We'll have to manage that revenue resource better. I think that there will be some slowing down of that, I would hope.
You know, we're not talking about evolution, gradual change, development. We're talking about revolution occurring in PNG.
Our people expect us to deliver some real developments, and yet they are struggling with the impacts, and we just have to make these calls.
From a stone age, a computer age, a digital age within a lifetime. It took 10,000 years for Europe to develop as a nation state and a superpower. Now it's taking only PNG 35 years. That says a lot.
Why are we giving the derogation to Papua New Guinea? I tell you why, it's because it's literally on the other side of the world. And the likelihood of EU fishing fleets exploiting that area extensively is limited, but they are free to do so. There is nothing to stop EU fishing fleets fishing in the Papua New Guinea waters and landing their catch and getting their catch canned in Papua New Guinea, and that would be very good for development.
In August 2011, a new government came into power following a political coup. New promises were made, bringing back hopes for the people of Madang. They promised to review the PMRZ project and declared the environmental amendments unconstitutional. In January 2012, great news came when the parliament unanimously revoked the laws. But with constant political tensions, parties vying for power, and new elections coming up, there still remains important issues to be addressed by any government. Results of an inquiry into the use of public funds for the PMIZ project need to be made public. And the people must be informed about the findings of a criminal investigation into the alleged murder of a national fisheries officer on board an Ardi fishing vessel on the 29th of March 2010. The issues presented in this film may change over time, but they are reflective of what many endure when confronted by the exploitation of their resources all around the country. We left Papua New Guinea with many more questions than we found answers, but one thing is sure, the people of Rempi, Kananam, or Seg Island all deserve to have their voices heard in this free trade game.
Don't need a-